objects under gravity fall at the same rate. We all know this universal fact, but isn't that weird? A hammer and a feather dropped from the same height reach the ground at the same time. And this isn't so universal among other forces. Gravity is kind of the only one that does this. Think about the electric force. If you place a particle in an electric field, the electric force acting on a particle will push it, making it accelerate. However, this acceleration isn't quite independent of its mass. How fast a particle would accelerate does depend on its mass. The smaller the particle, the higher the acceleration. And so, for example, if the particle would have been a proton, the acceleration would have been a lot less compared to when it would have been a positron. And this makes sense because the two particles have the same charge but significantly different masses. So obviously one fell faster than the other. All of this can be applied word by word to a particle falling under gravity. But there, the same thing doesn't seem to happen. All particles, irrespective of their mass, fall at the same rate. The cause of this stems from the fact that almost seems like a coincidence. To start, we don't really know what mass and charge actually are. What we can say though is that these are some things that some particles have that gives them certain special features. But we really don't know what they actually are. We can say that charge quantifies how strongly a particle interacts with the electromagnetic force. Similarly, some particles have this special ability to resist changes in motion. We call it mass. Coincidentally, that same mass, which is the measure of resistance to motion, also happens to be the charge of gravity, the thing that quantifies how strongly a particle interacts with the gravitational force. Now, why should an object's ability to resist motion be anywhere related to how strongly it interacts with the gravitational force? Well, that's the coincidence part. To be clear, mass can be understood in two different ways. There's inertial mass, the ability to resist motion, and there's also gravitational mass, the charge of gravity. The coincidence being, why are they so equal? Obviously, they seem like pretty distinct phenomena. Let's come back to where we left. All masses in the gravitational field fall at the same rate because mass has a dual character. It's not only a resistance to motion, but when gravity is involved, it's also a cause of it. These two factors work in opposite directions, leading to the universality of free fall. Or that's what classical physics would tell us. But how does this plain old mass, which is about resistance to motion, come to have anything to do with how strongly it is interacting with the gravitational force? We'll have to look a bit deeper. We already said that objects experience different levels of acceleration depending upon their masses. What is this mass and where does that come from? Well, this idea is very similar to the idea of inertia. Inertia is the tendency of objects to resist changes in motion. Mass is a measure of inertia. The fastest speed at which things can travel in our world is the speed of light, which can be thought of as having no resistance to motion. So what that means is that there's something that some particles have that gives them their ability to resist changes in motion. We call it mass. Not all particles have it, and different particles have that in different amounts. There was a time, there are some theorists that say, there was a time very close to the Big Bang before which none of the particles had any mass and all of them traveled at the speed of light. But then something happened and some of these particles got mass. That thing was spontaneous symmetry breaking, and after that what remained was a field with non-zero potential at all points in space. That field was Higgs field, and so essentially any particle that can interact with that field because of its positive potential would have to do it all the time. And this forever interaction is essentially what mimics mass. You can look for Higgs mechanism if you want to know more. And so obviously there are also particles that do not interact with that field at all, and so they remain, as you call them, massless. A familiar example is light. If we want some analogies, think about an ocean that fills up the entire universe, that ocean being the Higgs field. Now, any particle that can experience this ocean would feel some resistance to motion. This is pretty much the basic picture of the origins of mass, but we still haven't quite talked about how this mass is related to the gravitational mass. This might very well solve the puzzle for us. Turns out, gravity isn't really a force, at least not according to general relativity, which is our best description of gravity. The central idea comes from the equivalence principle. The equivalence principle says that the effects of uniform gravity are completely identical to acceleration. If there's a rocket ship accelerating upwards at precisely the acceleration provided by gravity here on Earth, we wouldn't quite notice any difference. To any inside observer, it would seem like there's a force acting on them. We would know that that force is actually coming from the upward acceleration of the ship, but if that inside observer is really smart, he could work out some things, and then he would attribute the force from his reference frame to the curved geometry of space. Coming back to Earth, there would be quite a few changes. First up, Earth's gravity isn't uniform, so it's not exactly like traveling in a ship with upward acceleration. But still, we can say that there is something that we call mass, and that affects the fabric of space-time, bending it in certain ways, and objects traveling under no force through this curved space-time would seem like accelerating, because the paths they are traveling through itself are curved. And straight lines in curved space don't look straight. And now it's sort of clearing out a bit. Two objects with different masses fall at the same rate because they aren't really falling. They are just following straight line paths through curved space-time. So the gravitational charge is the gravitational mass of the object. And that's because mass curves space-time, and that leads to gravity. And why does mass curve space-time? Well, because technically it's energy that does it, and mass is just another form of it. And so objects, irrespective of their mass, fall at the same rate. And gravity is quite different. Thanks for watching. Bye.